Twilight on the starts of the video. I'm Ari Silverman, I'm originally from Australia. I've been in various frameworks. I also studied at the Shared Leadership up to CEO. And we'll be presenting together with Eitan, which is actually quite a big deal, given that Eitan is one of the main editors of a lot of Rav Shekhar's writings. Together, it's an interesting combination. But what we plan to do today is focus on the question of psak, right? In the writings of Rav Shekhar, focusing mainly on one of his articles that appeared in connection with Yom HaTzmaut. And the question of psak in general in the modern world, I think, is very important, especially in light of what Rav Shekhar writes, but in general, and I think we see this as well, right? There's, because of the assumptions that people bring to the table in the modern world, not only in relation to psak, but in relation to many other things, it's difficult for people to sometimes believe that it's possible to arrive at a particular decision, or it's difficult for people to believe that one's the motivations of a posek, right? By the way, if I say a Hebrew word and people, I assume everyone here knows the Hebrew words, but if I say one and you don't stop me, that the motivations of a posek are pure and l'shem shamayim. And in general, when we approach many things, I think, in the modern world, we approach them from a perspective of skepticism, right? Is that person saying that because that's what they believe, or is that person saying that because of how they were raised, right? And for psak, I think we see today that it affects it, right? As much as people perhaps try to disregard that aspect of modernity or postmodernity, it comes in a variety of frameworks of when exactly is the authority, right? How exactly do we decide this? If there are a range of options, anyone who's learned halakha knows, even in Shulchan Aruch it says, you know, yesh omrim, and there's a masorah about how we rule, but you know, what does that even really mean? And so that in and of itself is a question, and Rav Shekhar deals with aspects of that question itself in a way which doesn't, I don't think, reject those questions or reject that reality, but deals with them and gives voice to them and answers them as well and provides a way through them, I think. And I think also dealing with psak in light of Rav Shekhar's thought is important because, firstly, psak and halakha is instrumental to Judaism, right? It's central to everything we do and everything we think. And on the other hand, it's one thing for a theologian like Rav Shekhar and Rabbanim to debate things philosophically and to talk about, you know, ideas about things and have discourses on Rabbi Nachman. It's another thing to say, well, what do we actually do before? Right? What do we, after everything's said and done, what do we do? And so we're not reading a psak of Rav Shekhar, which is important to note, but more his relationship to it. But even in that, I think it has a lot of value to it. Do you want to say anything? Okay. So to begin with, we're going to read Chazon Ish, dealing with the question of the setting down of a fast day or a day of commemoration for Yom HaShoah, and whether we have the right to do such a thing. And we're using this more as a foil, and Rav Shekhar also brings this approach as well, this exact comment, to understand the Haredi approach, or the more classical, maybe Galuti approach, you might say. But we'll read it in English. It's the first source on the page. Halachic issues are fixed according to the Torah, and no prophet is allowed to change them until he finds support in the Torah. And just as removing is a distortion of the Torah, so too the addition of Torah mitzvot is a distortion of the Torah. And the suggestion to establish and decree essentially another day of fasting or mourning is making light, God forbid, at the foundation of the halakha, and it is fitting to stop before it is even raised. Right here we see the approach, which is the classic Haredi approach or classic approach to psak, that there's a distance, right, between the world we inhabit and the world of psak, and that distance can't even be bridged. Right, once you make psak, and well, maybe when Eitan reads, we'll see, once you make psak relevant, it loses its sanctity almost. And so that'll be our starting point. And we'll see now what Rav Shekhar says about this particular point as a way of moving into the discussion on Yom HaTzmaut.
Apology first, I'm not as fluent as Ari, I'm not even close, so I have to rely more on paper than I would like to. Rav Shagal approaching Psak, if you see the second passage here, I read it some of it, and if, I think it will help to situate Rav Shagar between two extremes, ultra orthodox approach, like Chazon Ish we see here, which sees halacha as something eternal, metaphysical, unchanging, truth, unaffected of any historical, ideological, sociological, economical, all these things are external to the halacha. This is one extreme. The other extreme is one sort of academic approach to halacha. Rav Shagar usually is the main example for this is Yaakov Katz, historian who dealt with medieval halacha. And what he finds in this approach, I'm not sure if it's still actual in the academy, it's different approaches, more complicated maybe. But this approach, which is the other extreme, sees all these circumstances that I mentioned as the sole factor that formed the halakha. It's if Yaakov Katz is dealing with the example that Rav Shagar writes about in his book, what made Rabbeinu Tam to change the time of Kretschmar. So he is thinking about sociological aspects, economical aspects, and all the Shakra Vatarya of Rabbeinu Tam is only a cover for these factors, how they affect the conclusion, the halachic conclusion. So between these two extremes, what although they are opposite, what is the common to both of them is they both see tend to draw a strict line between what is inside and what is external. There is the internal world of the halacha, there is the external world outside, ideology, politics, economics. And they're disagreeing about the question whether there is, this line is crossed, if the external is affecting the internal. But they both see this distinction. I think what is special in Rav Shagar's approach is that he doesn't draw that line. He sees this, he wants to say that the halachic discourse is influenced by all these factors, as the academics and the, say, but it is not that he doesn't see them as external to halacha, but as an inner part of it. That's something we need to understand what it means. I'll read a few lines from these two passages on the Rav Shagar approaching Psak. The first one is dealing with the ultra orthodox, the second with the academics approach. So I'll read some. It is possible to discern that halacha is dependent on consensual forms. The range and complexity of various layers in the halachic discourse do not allow for one to collate them in mathematical-like form. The personality of the prospect, its spiritual and social context are part and parcel of your decision. This is one side. You can't look at the psak like it's made in an unpersonal way, like it's made from like the prospect is sitting outside of the world and is the source speak through his mouth. The other side is that in the second passage there, such forces do not act as external forces, but rather become part of the halachic discussion itself. They do not create an interpretation that exceeds the truth that lies in the halachic sources, because halacha is not a scientific fact but an existential and social truth. I want to focus on this term, existential social truth. This is the reason for what we try to understand here. I think it implies something deep and inherent in maybe all of Rav Shagar's writing. The meaning of what Rav Shagar assumes is that the meaning of our religious world, the meaning of Torah and Mitzvot, it depends on the way it shapes our existence. And not only, maybe not at all, on its metaphysic truth. Sorry to clear that. Things have to have meaning for our lives. They have to shape the way we live. And we live in a specific historic and sociological context. So if this halacha, this psak, is supposed to have meaning, a religious meaning, it's not an outside demand. It has to be something that speaks in our language. And our language is situated. It's not, we don't speak some metaphysical and eternal language. This, I think it's easy interpretation of the Hasidic attitude, strives for a relevant, actual religious experience, and sees this as the goal of Torah and Mitzvot. And I think that's why Rav Shagar, for Rav Shagar, the way the world, the Pesach lives in, and the Torah and Lev are not separate from the halachic truth. Say it again. The halachic truth gets its meaning from the way we understand and experience the sources we inherited. We inherited something, but the way we understand it shapes it from the inside. It's not that the sources are of the metaphysical truth and we stand from the other side. The way we understand things is part of what it gives it its meaning. In light of this, what we will see when we see how Rav Shagar reads, like Ari said, Rav Shagar didn't, he wasn't a poser, didn't write psikot, but he did analyze and taught shooting, tshuvot, psakim. What he's looking for when he reads posek is not to find out if his interpretation of the sources is correct, if it's objective, if it's undisputed. Rather, what he's looking for, we'll see that it's the places where he didn't, where his reading is not objective, that he had a specific manner of reading. This place reflect for him what is the approach of the posek, what is his standpoint for this. So the discourse, what he's looking, the halachic discourse, is not an ahistorical truth, but a specific existential approach, a way of living in the world that shapes the way the halacha is made. So the question for us, the question he asks, is not what is the correct answer for the question we will see, how to establish Yom HaAtzmaut. The question is, what is the world that we live in? What is our experience? What can be meaningful for us?
What's meaningful with what we're going to see is it's not just a statement when he says, you know, the posek is not just a technician, on the other hand, he has a connection to the past, but you see in the writings how he shows that in the poskim themselves. The choice to analyze Yom HaTzmaut is also significant. Right? Yom HaTzmaut's a new idea, right? It's also Klal Yisraeli, right? Or you're available for the important for the Jewish people. It raises a lot of questions in terms of context, in terms of ideology, in terms of the nature of the poskim who are dealing with the question. And in that sense, you really get a sense of what's going on behind the scenes according to the structure that Rav Shagar sets out in the beginning. And he begins his discussion in the article with Rav Neria. For those, is everyone aware of Rav Neria? A very influential religious Zionist figure in Kfar O'er, one of the important yeshivot. And then he moves on to discuss the opinion of Rav Gorin in the setting down of a new festival, which we're going to look at each of these. We're not going to actually read what they say because it's too time consuming. Just to know, it's important when you read Rav Shagar that Rav Neria's approach, at the end of the day, in terms of reciting Halev and setting down and the ability to set down a new Yom Tov, right? Essentially, he says, you recite Halel without bracha, and Yom HaTzmaut is important because the Jewish people were saved, not the Jewish people even, the Jewish people residing in Israel were saved from death, and that he finds his legitimation to say Halel, and it's also based on a very in-depth halachic analysis of the sources, particularly in the opinion of the Chatam Sofer, and he brings the Netziv, he discusses whether it's a Doraita or a Dorabanan to have a Yom Tov, also in light of Megillah Ta'anit, right? The Megillah that recorded the days of festivities during the Second Temple, and whether it's you're able to have a Megillah, you're able to set a Yom Tov in light of Chanukah, in light of Purim. And actually, his answer to the question about Yom HaTzmaut is not that different to Rav Gorin, as we'll see, right? But Rav Shagar's analysis allows us to really see how different they are, and then to give some light on what he sees. So we're going to read at the bottom of the first page Rav Neria's Rav Shagar's analysis of Rav Neria's discussion. And he says Rav Neria's discussion represents a moderate religious Zionist position. He tries to describe Yom HaTzmaut by utilizing existent halachic categories, pragmatic reasoning, and lacking a messianic ideology. Right, for those who come more from the milieu of Chutz La'aretz, right, it's not exactly accurate, the comparison, but it's like Rav Soloveitchik, right? When Rav Soloveitchik comes to understand in one of his drashot the sanctity of the flag, right? He doesn't talk in messianic categories, right? I never learned from Soloveitchik, but it just wasn't really his thing, right? But he doesn't talk in those categories. He talks about the parallel to the clothes of a Jew's murdered as holding the sense of sanctity and being buried in those clothes, and he finds a halachic category to make the meaning of flag essentially that people die for to also have meaning in a religious worldview, right? But that's similar to Robin Arias' approach. But anyway, underlying his position is the ultra-Orthodox approach, as seen in the writings of the Chazon Ish that we mentioned earlier. And as a result, he emphasizes the element of being saved from death, right? And he exchanges passionate patriotism with a security-minded approach that is interested only in the physical existence of the Jewish people. At the same time, he cannot disregard the overarching Jewish context of the event, right? He's a religious Zionist. He's not a Haredi. And so his position on Yom HaTzimut and the recitation of Hallel is complex and reflects the tension between these two points of view. He essentially says you recite Hallel but without a bracha, right? Because it's a question whether you can set a Yom Tov, a question in the case where it's only a specific community that relates to the Jewish people in Eretz Israel as a specific community. We're not talking about redemption, we're not talking about anything greater. And his approach is essentially this kind of modern religious Zionist approach in the eyes of Rav Shugart.
We will talk about redemption, but nothing is psak.
Yeah.
This distinction is what Rav Shugart recognizes the tension between two points of view. Yeah. Not everything that he will say in Varsha will come into psak. That's the difference. This is something that Rav Shugart stressed about Rav Goen. When you read Rav Goen, you see the way he reads reflects his ideology in a very strict manner. So there are no tensions. Much more core. And when Rav Shugart reads Rav Goen, he emphasizes how his religious Zionist perspective affected interpretation. This is how he reads the sources, this is how he understands his stand, his authority. And I read the passage in the page, the second page, Rav Goen discussion. Rav Shugart writes like this: the establishment of Yom HaTzimut, the colony of Rav Goen, is based on the authority of the generation poskim, the realization the uniqueness of the event, and the status of the State of Israel as the beginning of redemption, after the Gilgal. The victory in the War of Independence and the establishment of the state are not local events which save lives, like Rabin Arias said. I don't think that's the way he sees it, but that's the halachic language that he uses. Rather, they open up a new era in the history of the Jewish people. At the same time, those who reside in Israel are not a particular community, but represent all the Jewish people. Discussion entirely internalizes the religious Zionist perspective of the events, and so also emphasizes the gap between his position and the traditional halachic discourse. So we see a few points here that Rav Shugart stresses. First, Rav Goen discourse reflects his understanding of himself and the time that he lives in, a time when the Jewish people come back to history, and the halachic thinking that what he believes and what he does in his writing, the halachic thinking must also change. You can write psak the way it used to do. You can't continue to see the Jewish people as a community. You strive to exist physically and to preserve the unchanging Jewish way of life. This is something that even if you don't say it clearly, this is the subtext of the halachic discourse, the classical halachic discourse. He thinks that the novelty and importance of the events that occurred in his time, they give him the authority to change the rules of the game. He has to design a psika that suits his time. And the price of this change is what Rav Shugart writes, is the gap that he creates between his approach and the traditional discourse. And this is not a gap only between styles of psika, it's also a gap between communities, because when the Rav Neria, you can imagine how someone who's Orthodox will read and he can debate about it. What Rav Goen writes, I think it cannot be understood in a regular halachic discourse. So it creates a gap between communities, not only that in the practical conclusion that they say halal and they don't, but they think of halacha in a different way. For example, something that Rav Shugart stresses, Rav Goen, he doesn't ask like Rav Neria if he has the authority to set a new holiday. He believes without saying, not talking about it, that it's his obligation, it's not a question of authority, this is what he has to do.
And he is certain also that chief rabbis inherit the authority of sages that declared Hanukkah and Purim. He sees himself, I mean, it's himself, it's not his. But he thinks the chief rabbi is now like the Sanhedrin in some aspects. And he has not just authority, but obligation to set a new holiday. So that way he doesn't think of Yom HaShemot as something similar to local holidays established in the Galut, where there was something miraculous event, say Jewish life. This is not the way he thinks about it. He sees it a new holiday that marks a dramatic change in Jewish history. And it doesn't need to be justified in the same old way. There's a new way to justify it. Maybe old, even older than the halachic discourse we have. He feels himself as a continuing something from the Bible, from the Standing Temple. It's not, maybe it's not new, but it's not in a connection. So his confidence, it makes his approach more coherent. He knows what he wants to do. He thinks he has the authority to do it, and he writes it the sub. This is opposed to what you see in Rav Neria. He tries to reconcile his Zionist belief with the halachic attitude that is developed in the Galut. And there is a tension here, and this is something that, how do you think about Tzionut Datit in general? Is it something holistic, or is it a tension between extremes that always there is something a crack about it?
He writes in another article about the Sidur for Yom HaTzmaut. And he says, you know, it's a mishmash of all these different things, and Lechadodi reworded, and it's sort of like an attempt to make something great that ends up half measure and loses its entire thing. But that's exactly what we're dealing with here, right? That's part of what Rav Neri is doing with Rav Goren, is more about we're going to take the full step, right? We're gonna really go there. We're going to look at the next section, which is where Rav Shigar really points out how the poskim deal with their sources as being reflective of their relationship to the state and their worldview. Right? If you remember at the beginning of Vlad's talk, we read a section from Rav Shigar that he talks about, you know, whether the posek is a technician or whether the posek is has a social context, and we said that actually Rav Shigar believes that it's a fusion of both, and it's actually things working together, right? That the context becomes part of the halakhic discussion, and that relates to what we're gonna look at here. And again, it's worthwhile perhaps after this to have a look at exactly how Rav Neria discusses his sources and also Rav Goren. What's very interesting is that both of them, because you almost can't ignore it, both of them rely on the same halakhic, almost the same halakhic material. The way they deal with it is different, right? It's not that Rav Goren completely disregards it, right? He has a bit of pilpul and backwards and forwards, but it's a completely different relationship, even though they're the same sources and the same sugyot. So we'll read at the middle of the second page. The nature of Rav Neri's discussion is not accidental, Rav Shigar says. Firstly, it gives voice to the need to continue traditional learning by anchoring the new holiday in the old and recognizable discourse. Right, which is something, to be honest, as someone who comes from Kutzar, I very much identify with, right? This idea, and we'll read a bit more of Rav Shigar says about Rav Goren, this idea to be, you know, take the whole step that let's make Yom HaTzmaut a chag and the Sanhedrin is a bit scary for me, right? And it's obviously also a bit scary for Rav Neria. But what's important here is that Rav Shigar is highlighting this fact in the way they learn the sources as well, right? Additionally, there's a direct link between his relationship to the sources as absolute, which allows for his style of debate, pilpul, right, with them, and has them as allowing a range of exegetical possibilities, and between the transcendental view of redemption. The nature of his discussion reflects his identification, essentially, with the ultra-orthodox position. The absolute and ahistorical nature of the sources is also to do with the absolute nature of both halakha and redemption. From here stems the opposition to perspectives based in reality vis-a-vis those concepts, right? Which we spoke about in the beginning when we mentioned the Chazon Ish. The Chazon Ish, and maybe we'll read the source afterwards, the Rav Shigar sort of deals with this. But the Chazon Ish believes very strongly that in order for halacha to be legitimate, it has to be completely disconnected from actually what's going on in reality, right? In order for it to have that effect. So that's Rav Ner, right? If you understand what Rav Shagar is saying, and again, it's hard to do without reading the actual lines, right? But his relationship to the sources is mirrored in also how he relates to the state, right? And also halacha and redemption, and then specifically the question of Yom Hakim. In the next paragraph, he talks about Rav Goren. As opposed to the methodology employed by Rav Ner, Rav Goren does not debate, right, internal difficulties with the sources, right? As most people who are familiar with respond to literature do, right? You bring the Gemara and you bring how the Chatam Sofer understands it, and you bring how the Netziv, and the Netziv raises the difficulty with the Chatam Sofer, and then you answer why the Netziv is correct within his worldview, and why the Chatam Sofer is correct within his worldview, and why the Chatam Sofer essentially is right. And you go through, right? But Rav Goren doesn't do that very little in the way he deals with it, right? His style of learning strays from the classical methods and combines brisker lamdanot and an academic bent. His discussion avoids raising objections within sources and resolving them, and attempts to reach an objective understanding of the sources and the principles which stem from them. His discussion creates a continuity between himself and his sources. He relates to them objectively and not ahistorically. His psak stems from the sources themselves and not from the discussion surrounding them. He doesn't take a source necessarily and say, you know, how does this source deal with another kushiya that's raised in another sukkia? He says, you know, Megillat Tahanit was cancelled, right? And he engages with them in a way that relates to their context as well. And so we see from this, according to Rav Shagar, that Rav Goren's approach is one of halachic messianism. This is an integration of the two, as he calls it, that's pretty strong language, but intransigent extremes of Judaism. And it creates a view that is opposed to all pragmatism. Messianism at its core is not realistic, and it attempts to realize itself within history without considering the actual position of the world. Right? The question is really, is what's happening here really redemption in the way envisaged? Right. The integration of halakha with the messianic worldview strengthens this intransigence. This merger creates something very powerful that one feels in the passion that overflows in the writings of Rav Goren, or in the picture of him blowing the shofar next to the kotel. But the complexities of reality refuse to allow for such intransigent perspectives. Right? This year, actually, in Misrad HaChinuch, at least in the SOD, Rav Goren is the Rav they're learning about, right? Oh, in Gandhi, I don't know, my son. No, right, in Gandhi.
Stories for children.
Yeah, so they put out a book, and his wife, and he's running to the kotel in front of the chayalim, and the yonim are looking at him, and he's blowing the shofar. I think my wife cried the first time she read the book with my son, right? And Rav Shagar, interestingly, again, we'll see in his sort of analysis at the end of the day, talks about the strength in that kind of fervor, right? And in that ability to take that step, which Rav Goren does. But just to finish off here, what's important to note is how he links that to Rav Goren's reading of the sources, a reading which is like connected to them, and that is part of him and not detached from them, right? And he doesn't mefalpel, as Rav Shagar says, but in the same way, and he reads them and understands them for what they are. And in that way, he also reads the Mitzvot, the Sima kind of thing.
I think this, what Rav Ner is doing is complex because he thinks about the sources as something metaphysical, he has more freedom in the way, the way he reads them. The people he's using, you read, it's not a pshat. He has more freedom in than Rav Goren, because Rav Goren is really more objective, more realist. And what Rav Shagar says, maybe in a paradox way, that his objectivism is not connected to reality, because the reality that he talks about in the last passage is the existential reality he spoke about in the beginning. The question is, do we live in the objective world, or we live in something, all our world is shaped by the past, by our connection to it, and I try to clear that. We spoke about what Shagar said about how he analyzes Rav Goren of Rav Ner. What his conclusion? It's interesting that his conclusion is ambivalent. If you read the last passages of this
on page three.
Yes, page three. I read from the first passage. There is a benefit. There's a benefit to the position of Rav Meir. Despite the tensions inherent in it, the pragmatism of such position prevents one who follows it from striving for greatness and allows for the certainty of the continuing of tradition lives. It lacks the fervor of messianism, but avoids intransigence and militarism, not only allegedly, but also politically. So what we meet here, maybe it's not the usual side of Rav Shagar, we see in other articles. This is a conservative side. That's why I'm trying to clear where this conservatism comes from. He wishes to stay connected to his tradition, and he has this fear from strict and intensive approaches, insensitive. What he sees as insensitivity in Rav Goren is that he lacks the sensitivity that Rav Shagar stresses to the existential aspect of the halakha. So although he doesn't, I think Rav Shagar, as I said in the beginning, he doesn't see halakha as a high historic truth, like in the classical approach. But he believes that relating to it as such is something important, an important aspect of Jewish life. And the internal rules of the halakhic discourse should reflect that stance. So there is something complex here. That there is an objective truth that sees that the halakha is changing, that sees that our circumstances that affect it. And there is the way we speak of halakha, the way we write psak. And those are two different things. So there is the feeling of being an inheritor of a holy past. That's something that shapes the way psak is written.
Might be worth reading a couple of lines here.
In a minute. Yeah. What makes that? What gives this feeling of when you read Chazon Ish, the word that I have had in mind with the Ridat Hador? There is a side of the eternal truth, but there is also the side of the holiness of the prior generation, the thing that we are inheriting something that is bigger from us, that we have to have an honor for this, that we need to have some distance from it. And this distance can lead us to Pilpul. There is the side that we know that we interpret it through our eyes, but we do this in a way that shapes, that reflects this awareness. The passage here that wrote in the book, Al-Khot Olam, there is an article where Rav Shagar talks about these issues in general. I read something from this. The eternity, this eternity.
And to the bottom of the page three. Containing material.
Passage here. This eternity of the Torah is one of the central aspects through which holiness appears in our world. That is the sanctity of tradition which anchors the present in the past, and independent of the fact that the past does not change and may be made modern. Traditionalism, which is the heart and soul of keeping its rock, symbolizes the eternal and the permanent. It returns us to that which we experience as the innocence of childhood, an experience which is bound to the authority of one's parents. So we have to relate to the prior generation as parents, something with the safety. This nature of the halakha allows it to operate as a transitional object that returns us to the initial experience of unity. This holiness of the past stems especially from the fact that it is not tied to reality. The distance between it and the present grants it a certain quality and allows it to redeem our lives from meaninglessness. I think what we have here, and I really like this article because of it, it's an existential reading of the ahistoric statement that Chazon Ish is saying. Without reflecting on it. What Rav Shagar said, I think, is our ability to experience this kind of holiness. There are other kinds. There is the holiness of the past. This is something that is central. If not, maybe it's not the only way we experience holiness, but there is this kind of holiness. And it depends on the conservative nature of halakha. It's distance from our daily perspective, which Rav Shagar thinks, and that's a point to think about, Rav Shagar thinks that our daily perspective is essentially secular, mundane, and which he said in the last word, it needs to be redeemed from meaninglessness. And if we erase the gap between our life and the halakha, if it will be too actual, we will remain caught in banality. So he adopts the historic view of halakha that we saw in the Chazon Ish, but not as objective truth, but as internal game rule that points into the existential effect of halakha on our life. This is how we experience halakha, even if it's not objective. And that is why usually in this article and many other articles in other subjects, usually prefers of Neller's approach. Pragmatism, the complex, the effort to remain connected even when things are changing. And he tries to keep the ancient way up. We brought an example of a Savar. I want to try maybe later. How do we do a Savar in Lev Seder? If a Savar is supposed to express freedom, does it express freedom for us? Or it's something ancient that lost its meaning. What do we do with it? Do we make it actual and sit on the sofa like we feel free? Or do we preserve this freedom which is not a symbol of freedom for us? The example that we speak about, Rav Shugar accepts the way that Yom HaTzibut looks, which puts it in an inferior to the other holidays. Because this is the way you see our religious state. So, we said our issue here is not a question of objective truth, it's a question of our existential situation. What are the possibilities mostly for us? What Rav Shugar said is, even if the state of Israel is indeed truly a Tchatam Geula, we cannot truly experience it as a holy if it doesn't connect with our conception of holiness. And this conception is shaped by the traditional Jewish life in the Galut. So we are in a different time, but our language we inherited from our parents. The language is not only an example here, it's the main metaphor for what we're talking about. We learn the language from prior generation. Our ability to change its vocabulary is limited. I think that's something that Rav Shugar is very stresses it, and it's unique because in many discussions this point is not clear. If we go too far, the word that we inherited will lose the meaning. You can say the words. That's what Rav Shugar said about Rav Goman. He said the word, you last and a dream, but it really feels right. Can we say this word and feel that it's honest? That's the question he asked. And usually he goes after Ravera and the pragmatist. But in this article, and that's something caught me when I first read it, it's something unique. I don't think there are many other examples for it in Rav Shugar. That he presented different options. He puts it as an option that's important, I think, because that's the way he puts it. It's not its conclusion, but there is an option that he said. And I will read another passage.
The top of source 3.
Yeah, top of source 3. At the end of the day, at the end of the day, the graceness and self-confidence of our Goren allowed, despite the dangers that he concealed, for the expansion of the horizon of Halachic discourse. Maybe we should not fear treading this path, because it might be a necessary step in the process of moving from traditional psak to holistic national psak. Even if at this stage this approach leads to difficulties and contradictions and hides them with militarism characteristic of this approach, its justification might be in the creation of a new halachic tradition. Ideas and claims that today seem artificial and forced might serve as the base for a new tradition that will become with time, as the future will resolve the problems of present, to a legitimate reading of reality. So Rav Shugar takes a different path than he does in many similar discussions. Although he states that in our situation of God's approach is artificial, he raises the possibility that we might nonetheless take this approach and try to change our world artificially from the outside to the inside. The possibility to do that relies on the non-essentialist nature of his approach. Essentialist approach, it doesn't ask the objective metaphysical question. It's something that depends and can change in generations. So what looks forced today might be natural tomorrow, maybe for the next generation that will grow on Yom HaTzimut, that will look like that. And this language, the language we learn from our parents, it can change. The next generation can learn new words and new experiences. So when you raise this possibility, the question I was asking myself when I first read this article, why does it come here in Yom HaTzimut? In his book, Zot Briti, he has a chapter on Yachas to the Dead Chiloni, Tinok Shenishpa, and he has one on Giyur. And the approach he takes there is a pragmatic. He wants that, he goes with the Haredi poskim and not the modern poskim. And here there's something different. I ask myself, why does it come here for Yom HaAtzmaut. And it's something that connects to the subject itself. It's not just another example of this discussion. Because the Zionist effort is exactly that, to change the nature of Jewish life. And it has to be artificial in the beginning. It's a revolution. Revolution can't maybe be very sensitive in the relation to the past. There is the first violent maybe phase. But if the goal is not just to continue the traditional Jewish life in Israel, but also to create something new, new concept of holiness maybe, an Israeli religious experience. It's interesting what you said earlier about someone who comes from Hul. The gap, I think, that is created also a gap between Israeli and Hul. Because what the Rav Shagai in the Brashot Yom HaAtzmaut is talking about, what is Israeli holiness, what Rav Kook is trying, and he stressed at this point that it's not just to change something in the Yad, to say, it's not to change the basic concept, the basic experience of how, what it means to be religious.
So just on that, I think also part of it is, it's sort of what he said at the end, which is you can only reach the goal by taking the step, right? By being all in, by being Rav Gori. If you always just do the Rav Neri pragmatic approach, and that's why specifically I think Yom HaAtzmaut, you're right, that's why it comes in, you never get there, right? You're always, just before that, you have a Sidur that's a bit of everything and really nothing, right? And that's, you know, almost inherent to this this discussion.
I think what he's doing here is he goes with his Zionist roots against his existentialist tendency, that that's something unique, because usually I think his existentialist side creates his conservatism. Many of his students doesn't like that. And the question I'm thinking about, last sentence, this, he writes in another article in this book, that this may be the goal of the to create something new, to create something chadashim, something new, term used, that will be new, more rather new than authentic, maybe, from the, at least in the beginning. The question is, can we create a religious experience that will not rely on the yearning for the holy past, on the nostalgic side of Judaism, but will bring something new? He writes about it as bringing the Shechina down to history, to the present, the ability to create a holiness that is present. That's something that he can explain very precisely why it doesn't work. But he still has the option that maybe that's what we should do. And question, I think we can connect it to open this discussion to other something that Michal wrote me yesterday. Can we say that about feminism? About feminism, Rav Shagai writes somewhere, not something that we not published yet, that we need to be patient because we can't make changes even if we think they're right, objectively they're right, we can't change things too quickly because we lose the connection, we lose the meaning of what the Knesset looks like. But maybe we should do this step in other issues as well.
Maybe just to summarize from my perspective, when we started the discussion, I raised the difficult nature of Psak in our generation, right? And how you dance between this kind of how you read people and see how they do things. I think what you see from here is that's exactly the approach of Rav Shagai, right? He has this conversation going on about it's not, as we spoke about, this isn't a psak, right? This is talking about how he experiences things and how that needs to reflect things, which in of itself is a very sort of modern and postmodern approach. And he goes through and analyzes each of the poskim and where they come from and how that's reflected in how they read. And then even at the end, you know, if I started by saying psak is useful for analyzing the utility of postmodernism because you have to actually decide. So at the end, he's ambivalent and is explaining why each side is.
So we didn't write psak.
Right. I mean,
what about the Brisker, that they're not writing psak.
Right.
See too many sides, they can't decide on something.
Right. But I think what you do see here, especially in terms of Yom HaAtzmaut, and we didn't really go into so much, but his like the psak on Haseva, is his navigation through this kind of situation where, which in some regards might allow people to stray to all these essentially distant places, right, from the tradition, right, because it's about what I experience and what I feel. But he quite creatively, I think, navigates it within these like feelings that people have to a place like Ethan said, right, which says you can't, and we didn't read it either, but you can't just recreate Shabbat based on the demands of modernity and call it Shabbat. It won't be Shabbat, right? He said it might be a little bit like your month's mode, maybe. But it's not going to be Shabbat, right? And his ability to navigate that, I think, is the opening of a discussion for coming to some kind of resolution in that regard. And that's why it's quite it's radical. But I think it answers a lot of those questions that we have for people in the world we live in. Does anyone have any comments or thoughts?
Square.